For USCFootball.com, I'm Keely Eure here with Gerard Martinez for instant analysis of USC's second Elite Camp. Now, if you don't remember our video from last week, Elite Camp is a more personal, intimate camp with USC's coaches. It's an invite-only camp. This time around, it was about 150 players. Last week, it was around 60. But Gerard, let's start off with your overall thoughts, your top performers on the offense. Who did you see out there?
Yeah, I think you can't really overlook LV Bunkley Shelton. I think overall, probably just camp-wide, he was probably the top overall performer. He played receiver. He did everything we know from him as a receiver, possession receiver, very polished in his routes, great hands. He looked good as a receiver, ran a lot of underneath routes, didn't necessarily stretch the field a whole lot. But I think what he came out to do was show his athleticism, and I think he really actually did that on the defensive side of the ball. He was a guy that actually played cornerback. He played safety. He had an interception as a cornerback, a great diving interception, and he had a really easy play as a safety with an interception because he really read the play well. And so I think he really showed his athleticism on the defensive side of the ball in this camp, and it was intriguing to see him there. It's interesting to see how USC recruits him going forward. Obviously, they see him as an athlete, but I think he's a guy that, you know, as a receiver, he's been a guy that has been high on our list for very long, and I think just as a defensive back, really what he wanted to do is prove his athleticism, so I think he did that. Another guy on the offensive side of the ball, and certainly one of the top receivers in the 2021 class, is Bo Collins. Big 6'3", 200-pound wide receiver from St. John Bosco High School, one of the top receivers in that class, if not the top overall receiver locally. I think Troy Franklin probably has something to say about that up north, but he wasn't at this camp, and Bo Collins was, and probably one of the highlights of the camp was watching he and Damani Jackson, another young kid from modern day. It's going to be a rivalry there for years to come. And Bo was able to get the better of that today. He was able to beat him on a deep route and I think solidify himself as, again, one of the top receivers, not just locally but nationally in the 21 class. And then, you know, offensive line was interesting. Not a lot of huge names. But for USC, that hasn't necessarily been a priority, recruiting the offensive line. They've gone after some guys that have been three stars that have been more undersized offensive linemen in that 250-pound range. Guy like Joey Wright, who just committed to USC, is about 270 pounds. Kyle Juergens, who's about 250 pounds, another commit. Today they had Andres Durek there, and Andres Durek actually showed up at the offensive line camp and did some stuff at the Rising Stars camp. A bigger offensive lineman, a more traditional, you know, 300-pound offensive lineman. Certainly when you compare him to the guys that USC has had committed over the past couple weeks, not as mobile, not as athletic, but definitely a bigger body. So USC's been able to have him on campus a lot. And, you know, when it comes to offensive line, beggars can't be choosers, and USC just needs offensive linemen. So it's good when you get a solid top, you know, prospect, at least at that position here on campus.
Yeah. Now, on the other side of the ball, we didn't get to see much of the defensive line, just like USC's practices. They're kind of off in the side, but we did see them when they went one-on-ones with the offensive line. And a familiar name for USC fans, Marlon Tuipulotu's brother, Tuli, was here. And Chad Kay definitely had some good remarks for him. He compared him to Marlon, said he was similar, and said he was coachable. He had some solid reps out there. So kind of a top performer there on the defense. Who else on the defense stood out to you, Gerard?
You know, the linebacker position was, again, another position that kind of stood out. We saw at the first Elite Camp, the linebacker position was pretty solid, led by Caleb McCullough, who is probably the top overall player at that camp. In this camp, we had several guys. A guy that we really don't know much about and we just really saw first time at this camp is Keith Brown. He's from Oregon, Lebanon High School, I believe. And a guy that's, you know, solid, a little stiff in the middle, but a guy that's a middle linebacker who in position drills kind of struggled a little bit. It's kind of, all right, maybe ride him off. He's a good-looking guy. He's about 6'1", probably about 230, 235. But then when he got into 7-on-7, he looked really good. So kind of a little bit of a gamer there. A guy that, you know, I really liked, and I think maybe was maybe the top overall linebacker, was 2022 Tariq Alcuda, who got a scholarship offer after the Elite Camp from Narbonne High School. A guy that, I mean, in open space, very few linebackers really can play like him. We've seen him a little bit at running back as well at some of these camps. I think in the 7-on-7 camp, he was playing a little bit of running back. So a guy that, when you talk about athletically and he's out there on the edge, he can run with anybody. He can run with those linebackers. And a guy that's very young. So big, bright future for him. Another young young guy in the 21 class is Jonathan Flo, who came out with his brother. His brother was kind of on the sideline, but with John, he was out there playing, and he looked really good, also playing a little bit of one-on-one. You're really watching these linebackers just in pass defense. You know, they don't really get to hit anybody, so it's limited evaluation with the linebackers, but you are looking to see who's athletic, who can play in space, and those three guys definitely stood out. I think at defensive back, you know, Jalen Davies, a guy that's another young guy, another 21 guy out of Modern Day High School, also played very well today. I think that, you know, he did himself a lot of favors in terms of showing off, you know, how athletic he could be at some of those deeper routes. The defensive back position was pretty solid. DJ Harvey is another guy in that 21 class who has a load of offers who looked good athletically. He struggled a little bit in 7-on-7 in terms of his valuation. They put him over the slot, so in the middle of the field in space, he was a little uncomfortable. I thought he looked better in position drills when he kind of knew what he was doing and he was focused in maybe more man coverage. So that's what they do in these kind of camps. They're kind of putting these kids in positions that they're not necessarily comfortable with, and that really shows your athleticism because you have to sort of on the fly be able to adjust. And so it was a solid DB camp and a solid overall defensive camp, and that's kind of, you know, what I guess we got from it.
Yeah, as I mentioned, this is the second elite camp so far. The first camp was last week. As I mentioned, the numbers are different, but what else stood out to you about the differences between both camps?
Yeah, definitely. I think the high-end guys, there was a little more of those at the first camp. This was a bigger camp. And I had some comments, you know, everybody's kind of going, hey, is this really an elite camp when you have 150, almost 200 guys here? But it was. I mean, there's still a good number of top guys. But I think the first camp, it was a little smaller, a little more intimate. We got to see a little more of those players. And you get to see a guy like McCullough really kind of stand out. You get to see a kid like Corey Foreman just dominate. But in terms of overall talent, you know, this had more kids. There was more quantity here, and the first camp I think had just a little more quantity.
Mm-hmm. Now you alluded to this already, but Justin Flo in jeans on the sideline, what do you take away from him kind of observing this camp?
Yeah, it's just one of those things where you're trying to get a top guy on campus. You know, you want to get around him. You can want to get him around the coaching staff. He was having fun. He was laughing. He was talking to a lot of the players. It's just, you know, an unofficial visit. Obviously, he's here to watch his brother play. But it's just one of those situations where they want to get him on campus. They want to get him in front of Clay Helton. They want to get him in front of Johnny Nansen, in front of in front of Clancy Pendergast. Certainly just get him in here for meetings. And we know that, you know, he's going to be having a meeting with Clay Helton and some of the coaches afterwards. They're going to talk, go over some film, et cetera, et cetera. So one of those things where you just want to get that great player on campus as much as possible to make him as most comfortable as he can possibly be at USC.
Yeah, and speaking of official visits, it's been a week so far for USC as far as official visits go. They had some top prospects on campus this week.
Yeah, they had several top prospects. It started with Bijan Robinson, five-star running back, four-star by 24/7 Sports out of Tucson, Arizona, a guy that got in Monday and has been on campus since then. And you know, USC obviously trying to get the momentum going with him. I mean, he's been to Ohio State, he's been to Texas, been to a lot of schools, and USC hasn't been mentioned with many really four- or five-star level running backs. He's one of the lone guys that's really given him a serious look. So they're making their push with him. He actually ran into Adam Sandler, I guess, at lunch at Nobu Monday.
Nobu.
Never been there. That's sort of like an LA thing, you know, trying to kind of, you know, hit home. Hey, you know, this is where the stars are, and try to kind of make him excitement. And certainly a unique situation, a unique visit for him because of that. USC also having Ty Jordan, a three-star running back out of Mesquite, Texas, a guy that sort of fits the USC scheme maybe even more. That 5'9 range, you know, 180 pounds, a kid who came out here on an unofficial visit already. Sounds like USC is one of his leaders, maybe his leader. There's some talk like maybe he wants to commit over the summer, and this official visit will do a lot to be able to kind of hammer that home. USC really huge in Texas really right now because, I mean, you got Brennan Scott, also a big linebacker out of Dallas, Bishop Dunes High School, also on an official visit. Chad Lindbergh, another Texas kid on an official visit, big offensive lineman, four-star out of I forget off the top of my head where he's from, but another Texas guy.
Yeah.
Just a bunch of Texas guys. So Chris Thompson is supposed to be here from Duncanville High School later in the week. A safety, another four-star from Texas. So USC, this is the Texas weekend for them. Didn't see any of the coaching staff with cowboy hats on. You think they would maybe do that, maybe try to make them feel a little more comfortable, say y'all a couple times. Clay Helton can do that. He can get away with that.
But Graham?
Yeah, maybe Graham a little bit, but it's definitely been a big Texas contingent here for official visits this week, and we'll see how it works out. USC didn't have a lot of success last year with their summer visits. You know, they had a couple guys commit, but overall, the out-of-state guys and everything, they really kind of struck out on a lot of those guys. So we'll see if this is different. Obviously, the season is going to help them recruit a lot, and that's going to be kind of the telling tale, I think, if they're able to step outside of California and be able to get some guys out of state.
Yeah, you kind of already answered my question I'm about to ask you right now, but if you had the Rising Stars camps, you have elite camps, if you're USC, how are you feeling right now recruiting-wise? How do you close some of those guys?
I think you're feeling okay. You know, I mean, obviously, there was a big deal there with Chris Steele and Brew McCoy coming in. And that in itself, we talked about, that could create some recruiting momentum. It's not going to bring this tidal wave of 2020 commits. But I think it's one of those things, it's an ace in the sleeve for the coaching staff. If they're able to have a good season, they're able to get in on some in-home visits and some official visits later in the year. You have those guys in your back pocket that can host a kid on an official visit or talk to a kid and say, you know what, I thought the grass was greener on the other side. You know, I thought, you know, leaving California was what I wanted to do, and then I went to Florida or I went to Texas, and it wasn't everything I thought it was. So USC has that. But in terms of, you know, are they going to grab a bunch of kids? Are they going to make this big run up until September where, you know, you're going to have a bunch of four-star guys that are on the table all of a sudden commit to USC? No, I don't think so. I think it's really they're trying to grind a little bit. They're trying to get guys like Ty Jordan. They're trying to get some linemen into the fold, and they're just trying to work and develop this recruiting class from that standpoint. So it's, you know, it's development. It's certainly, yeah, there's some projects there, but that's really what it's all about right now until they get into the season and they can able to prove on the field that, you know, they're still, you know, a powerhouse. They're still a blue blood program.
Yeah. Alrighty. Any final thoughts before we wrap it up?
None.
None?
I don't have any final thoughts other than it's the last big camp of summer for USC. They're going to have a 7-on-7 tournament. They'll have a specialist tournament to follow this, but this is kind of the cap in terms of getting guys on campus. They'll have some guys in July here and there because the coaches are on vacation, but yep, they're able to come and go a little bit and just, you know, drive to campus and host some kids. So there'll be some of that, but there won't be any like official visits or anything. So this is kind of a big cap. This kind of this week is sort of the big cap until we get into fall camp, and then USC is going to be completely focused on Fresno State and trying, you know, that first five games, you know, trying to be able to get on the winning side of those first five games.
Yep. Alrighty, that's going to wrap it up from USC's Elite Camp. For Gerard Martinez, I'm Keely Eure. For more, check out uscfootball.com.